do want to commend you and have you talk just briefly about the fact that you started a campaign after Sandy Hook.
Yes.
And so tell us what the campaign is and why you were moved to do this.
Well, you know, as everybody realizes, I'm sure, and I mean, not realizes, but feels like I felt that day, I had been in a therapy session, so with Wills, and I did not know what had happened. Mm-hmm. And I came out, I took Wills to school, I was driving to another appointment, and my husband Michael called and said, oh my gosh, I just want to hear your voice after what happened in Connecticut. Now, I lived in Connecticut for many years, mm-hmm. and I didn't live in, you know, in Newtown, but I lived in Darien, so it's not that far from there. But it doesn't matter where I lived. It doesn't matter where any of us lived, all over the world. It was so shocking. I've never been so immediately devastated by something that I wasn't just personally and immediately involved
yeah.
in.
Yeah.
So I pulled over, and I was very pale, and I just kept thinking that this couldn't be. And I thought that this was, and it was, like the worst news that anybody, you know, that any of us could understand, that our children had been shot. And then the second punch came later that day when they started saying that this young man, the shooter, was on the spectrum.
Yeah.
And that he was autistic. And then I literally turned on the radio, and I can't even tell you what station it was. That's how numbed out I was by what this person said. So I wish I knew which channel it was so I could call them and educate them. But this, it was either a guest or a host, and I don't know, said, you know, maybe people with autism should be institutionalized. And this is a person that doesn't know about autism. It's not a person, it's probably not a mean, horrible, cruel person.
Right.
But I literally pulled over again, and I thought, oh no, this cannot be.
Right.
So I immediately called my publicist, Jess Block, who's also just an incredibly close friend and family member, I would say, of mine. And she has a son, Royce, who's on the spectrum. Mm-hmm. And I said to her, we have to do something right now. But it's funny because she was already calling me. So we like crossed, left each other messages, and then got in touch. And it was really, I said, I want our pictures up. And I want them to know, like, we are the face of autism. Mm-hmm. And they had that picture of the shooter. I never say his name.
I don't either.
I never say his name. Okay. That's like a crazy looking picture of this guy. And actually, Wills was the one. He got home from school and he was so shooken up. He was shooken up. But understandably so, he was devastated by what had happened, and he hadn't known yet that they were talking about autism. So he was going on Christmas break, and it was a very lucky thing that he went on Christmas break then, because I could shield him a little.
Yeah.
But then it came time where I had to sort of say, you know what, you're going to hear this. And so a couple of days went by when I finally told him, and right away he said, I want to say something. Mm-hmm. I want to get out there.
Yeah.
And that's when we talked to you, and we got Wills on the internet, and we got his picture and my picture out there saying, you know, and like he said on your show, on your interview, you know, think of me when you think of autism. Don't think of that. And autism doesn't cause violence, which it doesn't.
Right.
And so that's how Faces of Autism got started. And then we wanted people to send their faces of autism and all these beautiful pictures of all of you and your families and children and grandchildren and cousins and neighbors. And it just feels like we're strong, you know? When Wills was little, I felt very isolated, as I know probably some of you do.
Yeah.
And I hope you, if you feel isolated, that you listen to this show and you listen to us and you join us on here and you find us, because we're strong.
Yeah.
The autism community is large and strong.